Hello, I'm Dr. Howard Smith. I'm, as you were told, the director of the burn unit here at ORMC. We took in three patients from the disaster yesterday. I was told there were several patients transferred to Shands in Gainesville and to Tampa General Hospital as well. The patients that came to ORMC are in critical condition, and unfortunately I can't give any details due to privacy of those patients at this time. I'm more than happy to answer any questions with regard to the burn unit and burn care in general with regard to taking care of these types of patients, if that is what you would like.
What is the protocol when you get burn patients like this in?
Well, the protocol is extensive. I mean, there's various phases of burn care. First, we evaluate the patients and determine what they need with regard to life-threatening injuries, going through the basics of trauma care. We then proceed with resuscitation of the patients, identifying additional injuries that need to be taken care of. We proceed with the basics of wound care, cleaning up the wounds, removing any devitalized tissue, placing them in appropriate antimicrobial dressings, making sure that their tetanus is up to date, keeping track of their fluid resuscitation during this, keeping them warm, preventing hypothermia and cold injury from setting in. And then we proceed to determine whether they require surgical intervention and proceed with that if it's needed.
When patients burn seriously enough that they're considered in critical condition, what kind of recovery are we talking about?
Well, as a general rule, it's usually about a day per percent burn in the ICU based on statistics across the United States. No, that means that they're sick enough that they need to be in the ICU and need the level of care required in a level one trauma center's ICU.
How long are they expected to be in that unit?
Each patient is different, depends on the extent of their injuries.
So it could be a month?
It could be a month, it could be 2 months, it could be 3 months, but each patient's injuries dictate that. It could be just a few days. Well, it can be, in general, it can be the extremities, the trunk, the face, inhalation injuries where the trachea and bronchial tree and the lungs are involved, quite often the glottis, which is the beginning of the airway, and so they quite often need to have an endotracheal tube put in to help them breathe and be placed on a ventilator. Bronchoscopy and critical care services are needed to clear the airway of secretions and debris created by the injury. That's not uncommon for these types of injuries. If the injuries are more severe, we talk about first, second, and third degree burns. First degree burns, most people think of as a sunburn. Second degree burns are what we consider partial thickness. When someone gets a blister, that's usually what we consider partial thickness or second degree burns. Full thickness burns or third degree burns where the full thickness of the skin is destroyed usually require surgical debridement and grafting, and that's probably what may that's what we worry about may be required for these patients, and we'll have to see depending on each patient and what areas are injured.
How much of their body is burned? What's the percentage?
I'm not allowed to give out that information. You know, as far as closeness to the fire, they were close enough that they got burned. Other than that, I cannot explain where. I don't know any details about the plant or what they were near to be able to give you any information with regard to that.
Half an hour, an hour that's important?
Whenever there is a major disaster or injury such as this, we talk about a golden hour. Because there is risk of other injuries, especially an explosion besides burns, patients can be thrown, projectiles can hit the patients, they can have ruptured tympanic membranes or eardrums, they can have fractures, splenic injuries, the like. So there's this golden hour where we want to start their resuscitation as quickly as possible and make sure there's no missed injuries that are life-threatening. Resuscitation for a burn patient continues on for several days, but the first 24 hours is really important in regard to getting them resuscitated because they are very hypovolemic, meaning their fluid status is very low and they need to be resuscitated with additional fluids to maintain volume and prevent shock. So that occurs initially, and we start that aggressively as soon as they come into the hospital. Well, for the most part in the United States, we're pretty good about resuscitating burn patients these days. And it's rare that we would say these patients aren't going to make it. We would say that in patients who are elderly, who have very large percentage total body surface areas. Back in the distant past, we would use what's called the Bow formula, where we would add the percentage total body surface area plus the age of the patient to calculate mortality. We're much better at taking care of patients than we were back then, and so, but it still gives us a general idea of how severe the injuries are when you add those two numbers together. Inhalation injury, in addition to that, is associated with a 30% mortality rate, and that has not changed across the United States. So when we look at patients who have very large percentage total body surface areas and they're elderly and they have an inhalation injury, that obviously has a very high mortality with it. If patients don't respond to what we're doing, and occasionally patients who are of middle age, who have moderate size burns, don't respond to how we're treating them, and then we try to adjust the treatment to compensate, but those would be patients that might not do as well. I can't release the ages of these patients due to confidentiality. However, patients who are over the age of 65 have a much higher mortality than patients that are younger. Unfortunately, I have no information on that. I wasn't available last night, and so I can't give you any information because I don't know.
Did you see the video of the fire?
No, I have not.
You haven't? Okay. I just wanted to see if you could tell us, you know, the fact that there are only three here in critical condition. The fire, if you'd seen it, it's massive. What do you think this speaks to? What do you think this would say about it? I guess it's kind of hard because you haven't seen it.
I haven't seen it, so it would be very hard for me to conjecture on that. I'm sorry. Well, it depends on what time, who was there, where the explosion was, and their relationship to it. So, you know, if the area of the plant that exploded was not occupied, then I wouldn't expect a lot of injuries. We always worry about first responders being injured, you know, firefighters and the like, and secondary explosions being a problem. But until, you know, unless I can relate to that and see it, where people were working at the time, I can't really conjecture.
Can you tell us how many doctors have been on working with these patients?
Well, there were two attending physicians here overnight, numerous residents. They're on the trauma service and the burn service overnight, as well as the surgical critical care service who is helping to manage the patients. Then we have multiple nurses, both of the night shift and the day shift, who have already been working with the patients, occupational therapists, physical therapists, respiratory therapists, So there's a lot of people already.
Is there a timetable when somebody's out of the woods in this type of condition?
There is, but it depends on their size of the burn and how much of it is full thickness and how much of it is partial thickness. Again, their age, whether they require surgeries or not, what sort of complications they get from infection or hypothermia. And so all those play a role. So it's really too early to conjecture on that. Well, if they need surgeries, I don't know whether or not these patients need surgeries as of yet.